Hello, everyone, and thank you for tuning in to GeeklyEDU. In today's statistics topic, we're going to be talking about measures of central tendency, part one, mean and geometric mean. So the first thing we're going to talk about today is the mean. The mean, also known as the arithmetic mean or average, is the most common measure of central tendency we use in statistics. The mean is used in many areas of life. Some examples are in research. For example, an NGO might want to figure out the average age of smokers, which would be calculated by the sum of the years of the smokers divided by the sample size. In sports. For example, a baseball batting average is calculated by the number of hits divided by the total number of times at bat. In school, for example, a course grade average would be calculated by points received divided by the total number of points. And in business, for example, the average monthly revenue for a year, which would be calculated by the total revenue received in a year divided by 12. Which is the number of months in a year. So first we have to know that the mean is calculated by first taking the sum of values divided by the number of values. So for a sample of size n, we have this formula. X bar, which is the symbol for the mean or the average, equals the summation from I equals 1 to n, x sub I divided by n. Another way we could say this, which is how most people remember it, is this formula here, which is x sub 1 plus x sub 2 plus dot 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 plus x sub n all over n. The sample size here is the denominator, it's n. The observed values is actually the numerator, which is if I add up what they are totally. So, for example, let's say we have this number line, and we plot five dots on the number line, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Well, also just by looking at it, we can know right away where the mean is, but if we calculate it, the mean in this case is equal to 3, because if we plug all this into the formula, we end up getting this, 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 divided by 5, which is 15 divided by 5, gives us our 3. So, do outliers affect the mean? So, what happens if I take this 1 and I drag it and I make it more negative? Or I take this 5 and I drag it and I make it more positive? Is the mean going to change, and in which direction will it go? Well, we're going to find out right now in our next example. It turns out that the mean is affected by extreme values, or what we call outliers. So, for example, let's say we redraw that same number line, but in this case, we're going to take these five dots, but I'm going to take this 5, and I'm going to pull it out all the way to here. So we have something like this, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then we jump to 10. What happens to the mean? Well, in this case, the mean is actually 4, because, again, plugging this into the formula, 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 10 divided by 5 gives us 20 divided by 5, which gets us our 4. So it's important to know that when using the mean in central tendency, we must be very careful that if there are outliers, and many of them, the mean is going to be greatly affected by it, which would probably tell you that the mean is probably not the best statistic to use in that example. And our second and final topic today is the geometric mean. The geometric mean is used to measure the rate of change of a variable over time. The formula looks like this. X bar sub g, g standing for geometric. As we saw in the previous slide, x sub bar is the average. So this is the geometric mean or geometric average, which is equal to the product of all the values. X sub 1 times x sub 2 times dot 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 times all the way to x sub n and I take all that and I raise it to the 1 over n power. So we can write it like this in a fractional exponent. We could also rewrite this whole thing, if you wanted to get a little fancy, and use radicals, which in this case, it would be the nth root of this product would get you the same thing. The geometric mean rate of return measures the status of an investment over time. A little bit longer formula, but it ends up looking like this. R bar sub g, g again standing for geometric, equals the product of 1 plus r sub 1 times 1 plus r sub 2 times dot 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 times all the way to 1 plus r sub n. I take that product and I again raise it to the 1 over n power, but now I take all of that and I subtract 1 from it. And that will get us our geometric mean rate of return. N is the number of values in the set. Let's take a look at an example. An investment of $100,000 declined to $50,000 at the end of year one and rebounded to $100,000 at the end of year two. So we want to figure out what's the geometric mean rate of return. Well, first, let's define our numbers. So x sub 0 in this case is our starting point, or what is our investment, which from the problem is $100,000. X sub 1 now is the number of years that the investment is worth. So as the problem says, at the end of year 1, the investment's only worth $50,000. And at the end of the second year, or X sub 2, it went back up to $100,000. So as we look here, the initial investment from $100,000 drops to $50,000. That's a 50% decrease. It's cut in half. But then from the end of year one to the end of year two, it doubles. It goes from 50K up to 100K. So when anything doubles, that's 100% increase. So we have this. Now, this is kind of overcomplicating it, because just by looking at it, we notice that this number and this number, or x sub zero and x sub two, are equal. So whenever that happens, that means that the overall two-year return is zero, since it started and ended at the same level. So what happens if we take the previous problem and we use both the geometric mean and the arithmetic mean? Are we going to get different results? So let's use the one-year returns to compute the arithmetic mean and the geometric mean. One-year return meaning from the end of year one to the end of year two. So if we start off with the arithmetic mean rate of return, we plug everything into the formula. X bar equals, this is the 50% decrease, this is the 100% increase, so negative 0.5 plus 1 divided by 2 equals 0.25, or 25% gain. Well, that's a misleading result, because this is telling us that we gain 25% in the investment, which is not true. But if we use the geometric mean rate of return, let's plug these numbers into the formula. So here's our formula. So again, 1 plus negative 0.5 times 1 plus 1, all of that raised to the 1 half power minus 1. Well, we simplify this. And this, that gets us 0.5 times 2 to the 1 half power minus 1. All of this is 1, so we end up getting 1 to the 1 half power minus 1. 1 to the 1 half power is the same thing as saying the square root of 1, which is 1. So 1 minus 1 gives us 0, which is a more accurate result, because, like we said earlier, the initial investment and the investment worth at the end of the second year are exactly the same, so that means it didn't change at all, so we have a 0% change or rate of return. Thank you for tuning into GeeklyEDU. More statistics videos are coming. Don't forget to subscribe and check out other topics. See you in the next video.